There is much that we can do, much that we have done, much more that we will do to preserve the liberties that we founded this country on 220 years ago. And I believe that we have enough freedom still kindling in the heart and soul of every American that we can rediscover this country once again and put it back on a constitutional republic. And we can do it in short order. Because... So we the people are the sovereigns. We are the sovereign citizens. We are the sovereign people. And the government was set up to serve the sovereign people. So that is the principle that is central to the way our government works and to the way the political, economic, and legal systems work in every country and every power structure around the world today. Central to every war and every conflict that exists in the world today is the issue of sovereignty. Sovereignty is so key and so important that it is blatantly missing from our vocabulary. It is blatantly missing from our education, even our so-called higher education. It is blatantly missing from law school. It is blatantly missing. You don't hear it talked about in the media, except once. Only once did I ever hear the word sovereignty, and it was during the GATT debates on the floor of Congress, for those who were opposed to GATT. And they were saying, but this would compromise the sovereignty of the United States of America, wouldn't it? Yes, it does, indeed. And so do all the other treaties that we have entered into since around 1945, whereby we have transferred the sovereignty of the United States to internationalist organizations. And so, in order to have a sovereign United States of America, there have to be sovereign citizens and sovereign people in sovereign republics in order for that to occur. That's where it begins, with the people. Now, before I get into citizenship and the distinctions thereof, I'm going to illustrate the power structure a little bit, because it's a mystery to most people how this seemingly very complex structure of control actually works. But it's actually very simple. All power structures are derived from sovereignty itself, all of them. In fact, the sovereignty, you could describe it as the invisible part of the power structure. It's invisible to us. We really don't know who all the sovereigns are on the planet today. They keep themselves invisible and hidden from us. But they are the puppeteers, and they are pulling the strings of the visible part of the power structure, which is the part that we see. We see the nation states, we see the transnational corporations, we see the international bankers, we see the internationalist organizations like the United Nations, the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, the Trilateral Commission, the Council of Foreign Relations. These are all storefronts for the power structure. They're like Hollywood movie sets that all look like they have the power, but if you actually walk in, you'll see that they're really just kind of leaning up on 2x4s. That the power really isn't there either. Wherever the media directs your attention, that's where it ain't happening. If you wonder... if you wonder why our attention is constantly riveted towards Washington, D.C., and what is Bill Clinton having for lunch today, and when is he getting a haircut, it's because power ain't there. It's somewhere else. And so once you understand that that's how the media distracts us and keeps us from seeing what's true, you have to look in the opposite direction almost to find what's really going on. So instead of focusing all our attention on the visible part of the power structure, where the attention needs to be is on the puppeteers themselves, who are the sovereign powers that are behind the scenes of all the nation states, behind the scenes of all the transnational corporations, behind the scenes of the international bankers. And there is a lineage of sovereign structures that go back thousands of years. There's an excellent scholarly work by Alexander Christopher called Pandora's Box. Some of you may have seen this. It traces the genealogy of the power structure back 3,000 years up to present time to see actually where these sovereign power structures ended up here in 1995. And it's very surprising to find out that most of the people that are truly the sovereigns and the families that are actually behind it, you've never heard them before. You've never even heard their name. They're invisible. So, My estimate is today on the planet there are roughly 40 interlapping power structures in the world today that are the sources of these sovereigns. And they're all fighting with each other and wrestling for larger market share of control over the whole planet and the Earth right now, and all of the nation states, economic systems, and legal systems as well. They're not all one big happy family all getting together, you know, and chumming up. They're fighting with each other for control too. There's European power structures, American power structures, South American, Chinese, Japanese, Russian, a lot of power structures competing. And so who will prevail, we don't know. The cards aren't all on the table yet, and the chips aren't all counted yet. But nonetheless, the principle is the important part here. It's behind the scenes is where you have to look to find where power actually exists in the world today. And then, once the people reclaim their sovereignty and their sovereign citizenship, then we know who we're dealing with, because we're dealing on an equal par with those same power structures that are out there manipulating, controlling everybody else who has taken on a subject or a slave status. So, that's about all I'm going to say about sovereignty right now. We're going to keep coming back to it because, in conclusion again, sovereignty is the central concept around which all political, economic, and legal systems revolve. That is the issue. Who is going to be the sovereign? Who is going to prevail? Is it going to be the sovereign powers who are the creditors of this government? Or is it going to be we the people, the sovereigns? Which one are going to prevail? That's the question. We are. We shall prevail because there's no empire in history that has ever been able to squash a free people, ever. Maybe for a little duration or a short period of time, they may put the shackles on for a little while. But most of the shackles they have today are psychological shackles, and they're shackles of information where they keep the information from the people. And once we release those shackles and those chains from ourselves and release ourselves from legal slavery, economic slavery, mental slavery, etc., and we liberate ourselves, then we are unstoppable. So that is my vision and my focus, and ours as well for today. And that's where we're going to end up after about 2 hours tonight. And I hope that this will inspire all of us to take the next step to reclaim our sovereignty. So next, I'm going to talk about citizenship and the distinctions thereof, and we're going to review some points in history also, and I hope this will clarify it for people who maybe have just been introduced to this and aren't really clear what a state citizen is versus what is a American national versus what is a sui juris free person. There are some fine line distinctions between these various classifications of free people, and I hope we'll make those clear tonight. Prior to 1868 in this country, there was no such thing as a United States citizen. They did not exist. It wasn't until the 14th Amendment that the U.S. citizen was created as a legal person born or naturalized in the United States. Prior to that, and at the founding of this country, were state citizens. If someone existed as a preamble citizen in the sovereign state of Virginia or New York or Pennsylvania, they considered themselves a Virginia citizen, a New York citizen, a Pennsylvania citizen, etc. They never thought of themselves as United States citizen. Prior to the Civil War and prior to 1868, no one ever referred to themselves as a U.S. citizen. Not even if they resided in the District of Columbia. They still considered themselves citizens of Virginia or New York, etc., etc. So it's a rather new concept, only about 130 so years old. But 220 years ago, firmly founded on those documents of American law that I already mentioned, the sovereignty was vested in the people. And the Treaty of Paris with Great Britain at the conclusion of the American Revolution said quite literally that the people shall have the same prerogative as the king. Now, you don't have to be a genius to figure out what that means. If you're a king or a queen or a sovereign, it means there's no superior authority. There's no one you have to answer to except God and natural law and unalienable rights and all that. The natural law, that you do answer to. But there was no other human government or human being that you answer to as a sovereign or as a sovereign citizen. The American Revolution was fought on one of the issues was on the issue of land ownership and property ownership. And that at the conclusion of the American Revolution, the American people held the allodial titles to their property. An allodial title is another word for sovereign. If you were a king or a sovereign and you owned a piece of property, you didn't pay taxes to anyone. You didn't have anybody regulate you. There was no building codes. There was no zoning. There was no environmental laws. There was no other encumbrance that could attach to a sovereign property, to an allodial title. An allodial title is superior title. There is no superior title than a land patent.